done jiu-jitsu before?
Nope.
So this is like your first class?
Yep.
Okay, cool. You're gonna be a weird jiu-jitsu dude. With a really simple truck entry, it's just like a modified back kick, and we'll go over some of the basic stuff from there. So I use you, Randy, since you're my best boy. So he's gonna be internal. And I'm gonna be over here. And I'm just gonna do like a cross side back kick. So most people that have been doing jiu-jitsu for any time, they've seen something like this, and then we fall, and now I'm on his back. So we're just gonna modify that to obtain the truck position. So, I need to get a lane open on this side of the body. And there's a few ways I can do that. I can reach in and do an L frame, push that out. I can reach inside, pull it across. I can reach in front, pull it across. I can threaten chokes to get him to pick his hands up. He can just be bad at turtle and leave it open. But whatever you like to get that space open, get that space open. For me, I'm usually going in front and pulling that across. So if you don't have a favorite, just do that. And I'm sitting with this knee down and this knee up. I'm going to switch to that knee down. I'm going to step that foot to the inside, right? Now I'm going to let that go. I'm going to post and turn as I slide my foot all the way through and I poke it. So let's rotate this way now. So I poke my foot all the way around. That's important. And then I like to go ahead and triangle there because I'm going to do this instead of a lockdown as I fall back. So then I control the foot, post, fall, triangle, hook, like that. That's my lockdown. That makes it harder for him to do these reversals where he hips out, pulls that, and now he's got me in the truck. If I've got his foot latched on like that and he starts trying to do that, he's going to put himself in the V-ball. So from here, first submission I always try, I use my lockdown foot. Bring it close, pull it down. You can go here and finish. That's what's commonly taught, but I was at a sub-only tournament once. It was like a 10-minute round, and I held the dude like this for 3 minutes straight, and he didn't tap. So I lost a little bit of faith in finishing like this. But then I fought that same dude 6 months later, and I made a modification, and he didn't tap, and it hurt his knee. So rather than just here and pulling with my hands, I'm going to shoot that over and rear naked choke it. And I've not had anyone not tap to that and some injury not happen to their knee. So be careful with it. If you got someone who's stubborn, you know, at your home gym or whatever, and they're not tapping, they're like, okay, homeboy, and let it go. Because I have hurt people's knees with that didn't want to tap. So we're here, pull it down. It's in the crook of my elbow, gable grip, pull it, and they will likely tap. And that's the only sub will work for now. So we'll just do this. You need to be careful. If I grip like this, my elbow's in. I'm not leaving it flared. And then when I go to shoot over, I'm grabbing my hands together so he can't pull that off in our way. So does everyone need to see that again? One more time. So get the arm out of the way. Again, no many ways to skin that cat. Step over. I turn my hip, so I'm facing forward. Now I'm facing back. My foot's hooked over his leg. I'm grabbing his leg, post, fall back. This foot goes under this calf, this foot hooks onto his leg, and then I extend. That becomes my lockdown. Then I use that foot to pull it down, grab it, shoot it over. There, you can also finish like this. I've done both. Yes. Is that fair?
Sure.
All right, let's work on that.
It's gonna be real similar stuff throughout the day. Now we're gonna work a same side attack to it. So, this time I'm going to start on the side that I want to set up the truck. And I'm going to go double under hooks. So most people play seatbelt, so they want to play under choke and whatnot. But truck is not really for choking. Truck is for twisting off lower parts of their extremities most of the time. So I want double under hooks so I can control his body. Now, if he's in tight, he's making it light hard on me. I'm going to turn my shoulders and raise this elbow that's on the near side to open him up. So I'm here, I'm just using an S grip, so my fingers are curled like that. I'm turning my shoulders and using this elbow to open up that space. Then I'm sliding this leg in, and I'm going to follow my hip. And I'm going to establish my lockdown. Now I'm going to pull this arm out and hook this arm up to pull him
towards his back. Now I can go back down here, play my calf slicer, my banana split. So the calf slicer is the same as before, the banana split. This time, ideally, we're rear naked choking his leg. If your arms aren't long enough to do that, you can work this, and then it's just extend my lower body weight and pull that down. Going back to the initial position, this is a really easy way to get into a twister. So I've already got his arm pulled across here. I just need to insert this arm and get it behind my head. Then I go around his head and I clasp together. Sometimes if you got short arms, it can be hard to reach this. If they're long enough, it may just not be there. That's okay. I don't think we have anyone. Randy might have a hard time getting Hasnick in it, but everyone else should probably be able to put the part. And Brian's back is bad, so maybe don't do this one to him. But then it's just like the twister. I push with my legs and I pull up my upper body, and it is a spine submission. The finish of it is pretty nasty, so go easy with it. And again, if you're doing this to somebody and they're not tapping, they're like, okay, buddy, and move on with your life. Then if I'm not getting any submissions in the truck, I can just extend away, set my hook, and now I'm just playing normal back and forth. So once more, just fluid. Oh, and then details added. Josh mentioned, and I have run into this when I'm teaching to people, not everybody can reach this. So if you can't reach this and you're working that other finish, elbows tight, as high on the foot as you can get, because what people are gonna do is just extend their leg away. So if I'm here and he's strong, I can't pull that down. But if I get to his toes and I bend his foot, I can pull it down. And then I don't do this when I do my rear naked choke finish because there's no room to get my foot there. But if you have this and you have the space, it's better to put your foot against your foot and then you push-pull like that. So if you're doing this finish, this is the better way to do it. If you can reach it, I do stand by this being optimal, but not everyone can reach it. Any questions about any of that? Can you see it again?
On the twister finish, is it better to go under the neck right here or higher up on the head?
It's probably more leverage higher up on the head, but you're also risking sliding off.
Yes, exactly.
So I would say you got to feel it out based on how they're kind of being smaller. I usually do reverse Kesa and pull his leg over. A lot of times what will happen is they'll be hipping out to replace guard, and I'll follow with my knee to suck that space up. Then I'll sit through to my hip. And so we kind of pull themselves to his side. So you can work it both ways. They're kind of putting themselves on the side. I probably use it this way more than anything, because if they know what you're doing and they're laying on their back, they won't let you pull that leg. They'll keep it posted. So a lot of times I use this injury when they're trying to replace guard. So it's when he hips out, I follow with my knee so that he doesn't have room, and then I cover his hip with my arm so he can't roll back. Then I cover with this arm and I sit through, bringing my other knee close to his hip. Then I'm gonna pull this leg over and step this one in. Then I'm gonna switch this one in, almost like I'm putting myself back in half guard, and I'm gonna go ahead and set my lockdown. You don't absolutely have to do that. Some people will grab their position as they roll, but if I leave this loose and I start rolling, and he's savvy, he's gonna hip out and reverse the position on me. So to negate that, I go ahead and set my lockdown. Now if he tries to do that, that tension holds it steady, so I don't wind up getting reverse. So he went to do it, or I pull them here, outside leg steps over, inside leg hooks back in, triangle, hook, and I kick out. Now there's two ways I can go here. I can do that inversion like I was just doing. So if I'm gonna do that, it's easier if I climb back up, arm goes across, and then I don't do a forward roll, I do a lateral roll across my shoulders. And we roll into position, and from here I can go calf slicer, banana split, twister, back kick. And for those of you that are interested, there is another sort of hidden submission. If I pull this leg down, I can control here, establish an ankle lock grip. Usually they're not tapping to the ankle lock, they're tapping to the hip. But if they got flexible hips, you might actually ankle lock. The other way you can enter from that position, if they know this, sometimes what people do, they make themselves kind of heavy towards this side. So I can't roll them. I grab that leg and I'm gonna fall back again.
Go the other way?
Yep. And now I'm in the same position. This is usually where I'll set this type of move up from. You can also go right here, and if they got a little dips, you can get a little kind of, it's kind of like the banana split, but it's a little more down like that, more in the hip block. Anyone to see either one of those again? Yeah, one more time. So, we'll say this time I sat through, I pulled his leg, step over, foot hooks, I set my lock down. I can invert. If I got a bad back or he's heavy, I grab, I fall back, and I really gotta pull this leg to get him over. It's not gonna happen necessarily as easy because he's flat on the stomach, but if I pull that hard, you can almost always pull him over. And then from there, just work the submission sequence. You can run through all of them or pick your favorite. I'm not as concerned about that. Okay?
Yes, sir.
All right. When you put someone in Kesa and you go to attack these types of slower body submissions, what a lot of people will do and what I think people should do is they'll hook the far side leg under and they'll extend away. That prevents me from doing the splitting type technique because his feet are hooked together, so I can't pull this leg off. It prevents me from calf slicing him because he's made a support beam. It can lead to the twister. That would be the weakness of defending that way, but if he keeps this arm tight, he won't get twisted, and so then you're gonna have to probably go back kick. But the order of sort of operations for me is I always start with the calf slicer, that's my favorite. Usually people will straighten their leg. If they're strong and it's out there already, sometimes you just can't pull it in no matter what. From there, I go to the banana split. To defend the banana split, that's when a lot of people go ahead and hook their feet together and extend away, bottom one, this one on the bottom. Yeah, because now you've doubled up on your support of the calf slicer. Then I'm gonna start attacking this twister. If I can't get the twister, that's when I'm going to my back kick. The person who's defending, what he's looking for is he's gonna hook those feet together, he's gonna extend out, and he's gonna try to make a pendulum motion happen that gets him on his knees. And he wants to get that arm across my body now. And now I'm in half guard. That's, to me, the most effective way to defend the truck. When people defend that way, that's where I'm like, oh crap, this is gonna be hard. I don't know, do you wanna drill that defensive motion? Or is it really on the dock? I don't want you people to be good at defending it. but yeah, that's what people do. That's what I usually teach people to do with, if I've half sliced them a couple times, they're like, how do I stop that? That's what I teach them. And then that's also the thought process I use when I'm attacking the truck.
Yeah. Show it just one more time?
Yeah. So, I'm attacking. A lot of people that know me, they go straight to the double feet hooked extend away. So like as soon as I get the truck, they've already set that up. They know what I want. But that's because they know me personally. Usually when I'm doing this to people for the first time, I attack this first. So if I don't get it, it's usually because they straighten their leg. Then I go to this. If I don't get this, it's usually because they've hooked it to the other leg. Then I go twister. If I can't get the twister, it's usually because this elbow is in tight and I just can't get the space. That's when I'm just gonna start playing my regular back kick game. Or I'm gonna pop off and reset and I'm gonna try to put him in it again. And this time I'm gonna try to get maybe like some better control on that leg so he can't get it away from me before I've got the self locked in. But that's, you know, more strategy and thinking than any particular move. And then that near side one, that's my favorite one. And less and less I do the inversion.
Step back.
Yes, that one where like, yeah, near side, raise the hips, step the foot in right here. That's my favorite entry to it. And then usually I fall back over roll forward. So like, I didn't show it, but you can from this same situation where we kick back, you can do a forward roll into the truck. But I like those types of entries less and less because it gives momentum for the defender to hip around and stuff. And then similarly, when they land on their side, I've grown to like pulling them backwards more than inverting because, like I said, people that know what you're doing, they make the leg real heavy. And you get here and it puts a leg straight in my lower back and I'm like, I'm tired of this. So at least if I fall back and it doesn't work, I've not put myself in a weird twisty position. But again, if you're young and flexible, you can do whatever you want. Okay.
So that's all I got on truck. Does anyone have any questions about anything from that position?
When I was blocking on my cap crusher, I was having a lot better luck. I felt more natural putting my shit in. Like,
sure.
All right.
So get here and block. Oh yeah, that's good. Yeah. Yeah. That, and that's probably like a body build thing. The lockdown is awkward for you.
Well, that, getting my right foot on this ankle.
That definitely makes sense to me. And then you can get some similar kind of bite down pressure with your knee supporting your foot. So yeah, that's good.
With your legs twisted, there's got to be half guard entries from into truck from.
Yeah.
There's a lot of like key lock.
I don't do them because they sort of involve like kind of bending under people, but like a really common one, I would do it. But I guess part of the reason I don't do it is I do truck on what would be my bad half turn side. But if I'm here, you can do this outside sort of lockdown, and then if you can get outside this arm, so like say he had, I had an underhook and he wizard, you can do your hip out, bring your head out, stuff. But I don't know. Yeah, those types of moves are uncomfortable for me, so I just don't do that. But definitely there, anytime you.
How about when they put you in half guard?
Oh yeah, you can roll to it from top half guard, but again, it's sort of a
awkward.
It's a very tight roll. Your leg has to be very high, and if it doesn't work, you get straight. You will roll into the truck.
Okay.
And I'm just not the person to teach that. Jacob was studying it. Do you know that one? One way you can use it if it's not your favorite position is if you lose the pommel on the slider pass. So normally when we slider pass, we want the underhook so we get that cross body pressure, but if I lose it and he gets the underhook, I can switch to controlling this arm and going around the head and settle my Kesa position from there. If I like Kesa and I just want to set it up, if I'm in regular side control, I can pommel to the inside of this frame, push that down with shoulder pressure, bring this arm out, sit through around the head, and now I'm in Kesa. So those are two entries. You can practice those as you're practicing the basic position. But first, I just want to get these basic positional details down. So when I put someone in Kesa, the absolute most important thing is this arm. Nothing else matters as much as controlling this arm. If I don't control the arm on the sit through, I'm not even going to have a position. I'm going to have him taking my back. So controlling this arm is paramount. The way I like to control it is with an elbow catch. So my hand's not even really in frame. My hand will be there as a failsafe, but I'm not holding with my hand. I'm drawing my elbow back. That also has the effect of kind of pulling his arm up. It sort of bends his ribs around my shoulders. Like theoretically, and I've done it, you could hold the position like this with no head if I control this arm. Go ahead and take my back. Yeah. It's hard for him to turn in if he can't get this arm back. Conversely, if he has the arm, it kind of doesn't matter how good the rest of my positional details are. If I don't control this arm, he gets it to the mat. He is gone. So, this arm is your lifeblood. If you lose it, I'll talk about what we can do. But for now, let's just focus on controlling it. So, for me, that means big elbow pull. Hand is a secondary concern. With this arm, I'm going deep under the head. If I can't get his head off the mat, I'll pull that to pick him up. Then I'll scoop that under. I like to grab the back of my hamstring. You go inside your knee. If you can't reach your leg, that's fine. Just apply pressure like you're reaching for it. Like I'm putting him in a little schoolyard headlock. Now this leg, a lot of people leave it somewhere like
to this shoulder, I have to post on my hand. If I post on my hand, I've lost this arm. If I've lost that arm, as we've established, I've lost the position. So this leg needs to go higher. Now if it bridges to this shoulder, my leg catches it. I don't have to use my hand. My hand can stay controlling on his arm. This leg, sometimes people leave it here, and there's a reason to do that. You can trap people, but in general, if I do that, he can throw his leg over. He's got him long enough, then he can roll me back, and now he's putting me in the truck. Now the situation has reversed. So a good kind of rule of thumb that I was told is knees down, heels up. So my knees are down, my heels pointed up, my toes dug in. Now, if I want to kind of make it really suck, I don't want to pick up too much because I'm here, I'm really grinding on him, but if he were to just bridge that way, I'm giving him too much of my weight so he can bridge me over. So I roll down and I push in from the side. That's how I get that kind of rib bite. And so the uninitiated might tap the pressure. Fortunately, you were told me he's not that heavy, so I don't think he'll die. But sometimes you'll get people that'll tap just to this what you've done. So big details are control the arm, elbow pinch around the head, deep to your leg. Knees down, and it can be up a little bit. It doesn't have to actually be on the mat. This is just sort of the exaggerated. Like, here is okay. This is not okay. This isn't putting any pressure and sitting yourself vulnerable. So you want at least something like that. And then have your partner kind of move around. You should be able to move with them. So if he starts running one way, if I let him go, so run all the way out that way, he can just sit up. So I got to be able to follow him. So he starts running, I'd be able to follow him without sacrificing my positional detail. If he starts walking into me, I'd be able to stay ahead of him. Because if he gets his hips too close to me and he gets his hands clasped together, then he can bring me across without me doing anything. Okay? So basic positional details, then have your partner kind of move around, try to sit up in you, try to bridge you over, make sure they can't, make sure the position's locked in, that's the type of technique. Okay?
Alright. Yeah, Brian's fine. I feel like someone else. Am I wrong? I'm wrong. Okay, no one else. Okay, let's move on to finishing techniques. So, I've got a very simple move progression that I'll do, and I'm going to go ahead and just show it all at once, and you can work through it at your own pace. Okay. So.
Yeah. The way my voice is different, but just seeing her.
Yeah. This is one of those invisible jiu-jitsu things that's kind of hard to describe, but I'm subtly turning my
lat pressure.
Yeah, I'm using this lat here to apply that downward into him, and I'm adding that to this arm pulling him out and his head pulling in that way. So it's like I'm kind of corkscrewing him around his rib off of my ribs. So if you imagine like my ribs a pole, I'm wrapping him around that pole.
I'm making noise. You're going to go from the left to heavy.
All right. Just that little twist adds some extra suck. The suck isn't vital to hold the position, but it makes you feel really cool if you tap someone with the position. So work on that. But as long as I've got good control on the arm, you know, don't worry about necessarily tapping people with the position right off the bat. It's a sensitivity thing that develops over time. And then how he's moving will inform how I move. And it's a thing. Anyway, the moves. So the first thing I'm going to start with is what we call a chrome lock, which is basically just a Kimura on this bent arm. This is not the highest percentage submission, but I use it to expose his arm for the further attacks. So the way this works is I put my outside arm here on his elbow like I'm wearing it like a wristwatch. So I'm not going in here. Sometimes that's what people see. I'm just lacing around it. If you're familiar with heel hooks, it's like a heel hook. Then I'm going to S-grip my hands. Then I'm going to walk in and raise. So I'm just applying shoulder pressure like that. So that's that. You can go ahead and get that pat. Then the defense is pretty simple, though. All he's got to do is straighten his arm. He straightens his arm, I lose the chrome lock. But now the arm's exposed to further attack. So from here, I slide up. And it's important that I keep my arm in between me and him, because if I just let go when he straightens his arm and come out, he's going to suck his arm in, and now I'm going to have to fight from there. So I need to keep his arm out. So when he pops it out to defend the chrome lock, I slide in. Then I'm going to push it down. And I can go straight to this Americana. So I can grip like that, push it down, hook it under my leg. From here, I apply that pressure. You could also like do that, like you're finishing an omoplata, but it's a very fragile thing. This puts like, I have to tap to this because my elbow is bad the second someone puts my arm here. So it's very powerful to do it that way. So I usually just try to squeeze and hip and get the tap that way, and I won't start actually bringing my knee through unless they're being really stubborn. Another move you can do is you can push it straight out. So I can go straight out. Traditionally what's taught is you stand on it like this and then you find the elbow and you push down, but that's kind of floaty and pretty simple to defend. So I found more success by stepping my leg over and then using this downward pressure with my knee and upward pressure with this knee to get the tap. It's still a little bit more sensitivity based. You have to find the fulcrum with your leg. So you might have a hard time finishing this one. If that's okay, don't worry about it, move on. When you push this down, people will defend by turning their arm one of two ways. If they turn it up, there's the Americana again. If they turn it down, which is what they should do, you're gonna have to go knee pinch, and then we're gonna work here to some arm ride. So I won't bother showing attacks from arm ride, but you can just get to that arm ride. And then everyone who's been training here has been doing a bunch of arm ride lately, so that's all those options are put forward. So one more time from the beginning. We're here, I've got the arm nice and controlled. I hook here. Attack the crumb lock, get your tap, they extend to defend, slide your arm in, straight arm bar, get the tap, they push their arm up to defend, Americana, get the tap, they turn their arm down to defend, trap, good tight pinch, this arm swims back in, doing that frame like I was doing when I was setting it up, then I climb back up, and you can kind of hold like this, but it's better if you can pin that arm under one of your shins.
Hey, any questions on any of that? All right, working.
I should reiterate, like, that chrome lock, if they're young and flexible, doesn't work. You can't, yeah, it works on me too. But like Jacob, for those that know Jacob or Bandy, I can't get enough bend. Like, you can do that, but if they're flexible enough to endure, sometimes it's just not there. And I showed this to a couple of the groups, but if you're tight on a chrome lock and they're just like, I can handle that, bro, they don't do anything, you can swing your elbow in and go right into your attack from there. Or I can swing my elbow out and go right into my Americana from there. So you don't have to wait for them to straighten their arm. You can just go right into your attacks if you want to. I'll also mention, out of that group, this Americana is the one I want. This is the highest percentage one. I'm going to do those other moves if they straighten because they're aware of that Americana. They're just not letting this happen. Okay, now, let's say we're doing this. I make my switch. I mess up. I lose the arm. Usually what they do is they'll go telephone. So I'm not able to get that arm out to attack it anymore. He's established this position. And I actually forgot, but Brian mentioned it. I'm going to switch to a position called Kesa Gatame, if you care about judo and Japanese terminology. Now the traditional thing is we push this across, we hip out, we go here. So it's like an arm over shoulder. I'll do an intermediate. I connect my hands in what we call butterfly grip. So I'm grabbing around like this, and it's specifically this grip that I found lets me get this position the tightest. So my grip there, then I'm gonna slide my hips down again and reassert myself in. So I was up here, because I was wrapping his arm around my body. I wanted that, but now I've lost the arm and he's gotten it here. So now I can't get as good a pressure there, but there's more space here. I wanna suck that space up. So I'm sliding down and up. So I'm closer around his head now and I'm butterfly grip. Now this is a little tighter of a position. I have more people tap to the pressure from this position than from the regular Kesa. So sometimes you can just ride and walk and get the tap. If they can suck that up. Some people can suck it up. I haven't figured out the body trait that lets them do it, but some people don't tap to this. What I'm gonna do is I'm gonna push that. I'm gonna start hipping out. And I'm gonna go to a standard arm over choke. And I'm gonna finish whatever I like to do arm over chokes from there. Which for me, I've already got my grip connected. So all I gotta do is push to here, re-grip my butterfly, which is what I like, then I sit out. Now there's lots of good ways, turning in. The way I've found that's just the highest percentage for me is I grip and I drop my shoulder like that. So there's, you know, anytime you're choking someone, you wanna make it tighter, you wanna make the triangle there and smaller. So I can do that this way. I can do that by walking out. Brandon Motley used to really like that. I never figured it out. But for me, I drop my shoulder straight into their throat and I sprawl my hips. So I have him in Kesa. I wanted to do those cool arm locks, but I lost the arm. He went to this. This is the most common thing people do. I start going Kesa Gatame, see if I get the tap. If I can't, push the head, re-grab my thigh, walk out until my head gets on his arm. Now my head's holding his arm in place.
then I can reconnect my hands, and then I'm swinging down, and you can do your favorite finish. I don't need you to do mine, but then I like to do that. So if you don't have a favorite finish yet, try doing that shoulder.
Yeah.
Okay?
Yeah.
All right. Let's work on that, and then I think we have a bailout, and then we're done. So that nature of this entry, they are kind of in like a telephone defense already, so sometimes what happens when you're entering, if they're savvy, they'll get that outward pressure on you. Yeah, so he never lets me really set it. And this isn't specifically for this. This is any arm over choke. You can make a switch to the back. So I can start walking this way and pull them up like that. And then go for my chokes from there. So that's any arm over choke.
Push that one more time.
Yeah. So I'm attacking. He's pretty savvy. He knows this is a way that he can fight back. It's kind of strength-based. So if I'm really strong, I'll just be like, hey, bro, cool. But I'm just going to push that back in anyway. But if he's strong enough to fight me off, sometimes you won't be able to get your arm over choked. So it's here. He gets that outward flare. And it's just, I can't get enough tension around his neck to finish. So I'm going to walk up. Then I'm going to use this grip to pull him to his butt. And I'm bringing my arm around. So I was hooked way over here. As I pull him up, I'm switching that to like a seat. And then I like to just lock in chokes as soon as possible, and I'll worry about my hooks and stuff later, but you can take it back and do whatever you like from here. You can drill that in a second when we're doing this other thing too, because they're both kind of doing the same thing. So now, what do I do if I was going for Kesa and I lost the arm, or I had him in Kesa and he lost the arm? So what I mean by that is, I lost control of the arm, he pulled it, because what he really wants to do is put his elbow in between us. This is the worst case scenario for me, because now I'm in danger of him if he gets his head past this arm, which is pretty likely. Now he's just straight up behind me, right? So what I need to do, as soon as I recognize that's happening, I need to post, swim this to here. Now I can just climb back up and settle here. We can go to darts and stuff, but usually they start climbing up. So the second his elbow comes down, he's like getting on his knees and stuff. So what I'm gonna do is wrap up that arm in guillotine. So, he pulls his elbow down. That's my cue to come here. He's probably already coming up to his knee. So I'm gonna step and wrap my outside arm around his neck. Then I grip here. Then I'm gonna sit through to here. Then I finish by crunching in. A lot of times they'll recognize the threat and roll over. You can follow the mount, finish from there. You can follow the side control. Switch it to a darts choke if you know what that is. If you don't know what it is, just do the basic guillotine finish from the back. So does anyone see that again?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so I had Kesa, or I was entering Kesa, or whatever the situation, he gets this arm here. So I'm like, oh crap. First thing I do is there, I'm making his underhook weak. He wants that underhook to fling me off to there so he can climb up and take my back. So I'm using my elbow to collapse it. I haven't killed it, but it's not strong. Then I'm stepping up and around because I want to be facing him when he gets to his knees. I don't want him to be behind me. Then because he's climbing up, the space to come under there is usually there. Then I'm just gripping my hands. I like this grip. If you got a way you like to do guillotines, do that. Then step there, swing this foot to his hip. This is the ideal situation to finish the guillotine. Sometimes they kind of beat you to the punch before you can get that leg over the back. They'll do like forward rolls and stuff, fall off to the side. So I can step over to mount, finish by hipping in, or I can come to side control, then I just switch my arms through, and it's a darts choke, and I can go for that. Okay, give that a try. Again, if you're newer, or you're working with a new person, just stick to the guillotine finish from your back, don't worry so much about the follow-ups. Okay, I think, yeah. So, some of those near side attacks work in like underhook Kesa too. I know some people, especially Nogi, they prefer the underhook Kesa. They're a little harder because you don't have this isolated control on the shoulder, but they're possible. That's the only other kind of closing remark I think I have. Does anyone have any questions over anything at all? Could be Kesa, could be other stuff. Okay, cool.
From your personal experience.
I did forget one thing. We'll do the thing I forgot, but go ahead with your question.
What is your personal, since you use this position a lot, do you personally get the chest compression most, or is like...
I think I get the chest compression the most in training, but you gotta filter that for like white belt noise, because it's mostly white belts tapped into the pressure. I would say I don't tap as many people that are as initiated. They understand that
how's
on the recipient end, like if John gets me in it and I'm still with both shoulders or one shoulder down, it sucks.
Yeah.
But I was saying once you start curling me around you like Josh Barnett style,
yeah,
that's a whole nother animal where
And also I think people are more likely to tap two position in like training. I would not feel confident at a competition that I could make someone built up on adrenaline tap to the position. So filtering the noise for that Americana is the highest percentage of movement. That's the one that if I can get that's the one that I want. That's the one that usually once that arm's locked in, they can't get out and it's a matter of time before I get the tap. Yeah. That would be to me the A game. Usually I'm doing the chrome lock to get them to pull their arm so I can slide my arms over there and then just push that straight down. That's my sort of preferred
that we have already
plan of attack.
Now we have these that are going to
any other questions before I show you the funny move?
I'm not sure if you're addressing that at all.
Okay, all right. So this is the trap, and I just stole this from Stephen Cope. For I think he actually showed it on his Ludo Jake video when he went to New York and did this. So I mentioned earlier that you can lead your leg up and like sort of improper technique as a trap. So if I leave this knee high and I actually, if I'm doing this, I'll step it back and be like, please set your hook. So he does that to take my back. Yeah, he does that now. So I'm gonna abandon the head, step this leg to the inside, drop down and control the leg. Bring my knee bar or my pungal attendants. So you are inviting the hook and you're ready for it. It is risky. You know, if this falls apart, you're just giving up your back. So this is a joke move. I mostly do it if I'm kind of trying to clown on somebody. Do not consider this to be smart jujitsu, but it does work. It is a legit move. So I leave that there so he'll set his hook. Let go, step in between. Control. Basic knee bar details for me. Straight down the butt. Outside leg cover. If I do that backwards, I'm giving up space that he can use to get at me. So I want inside leg straight down the butt crack like I'm curling it around. Outside leg crosses there. And then I slide up the leg and I finish. And when you're grabbing it, don't hook up at the actual knee because he's just going to triangle his legs and defend. Hook up at the calf. And then you can hold the leg straight from the whole time. When I slide up, I finish by tipping in like I'm doing an arm. If he does triangle, or obviously that knee bar is not there, I'm going to hip out.
Okay.
Knee comes all the way down. That's an important detail on the honey hole. If I leave my knee up and I start attacking his legs, he's going to reach across my head. He's going to sit up, get his knees down, he's going to sprawl, and I'm going to be in a bad position.
So
my knee makes a wall between us. And then my favorite move from here is this little cloverleaf, but you're right.
She's probably
inside heel hooks there. Your top side ankle locks there. Your top side calf slices there. Your switch to game over is there. You know, no leg lock stuff. You can do whatever leg lock stuff you like once you get there.
This is all in the next seminar, right?
There's better people than me who do leg lock seminars. That leg entanglement, all of that is just me stealing from James Parker and George Valdez.
You said injury one more time?
Yes. I leave the knee high as an invitation. He sets that hook. Step in between. I hook up. Remember, I want to be above the knee. Fight down. Cover. Slide up the leg. And then, like I said, you can. At any time you're in a knee bar, if you want, you can switch out and go to this honey hole saddle position and then you know, work whatever your stuff is from there. So, okay, let's do that and then we'll be done.
kind of funny, just clowning on people type thing. But if you really like leg locks, it's a way to get the leg locks. I don't know what you were doing in Kesa if you like leg locks. So. But if you accidentally wound up in top position and you're like, oh crap, I don't want to be here. I could be attacking his legs. That's a way to get there. Which I guess also means if they have a single hook set when you're escaping the back, you must be able to get to leg locks from there too. That's interesting. That's for another day, though. So, like, basically, that's a back take where he has one hook, and you're using it to set up a leg lock. So that also must mean that from them having your back, you must be able to clear a hook, get your hips over, and make the switch to attacking the leg.
I would have to think about that more and pressure test it to see. It's probably not a smart thing to do, but it could be a funny thing. But like I said, that's something that needs further consideration. I'm rambling. Does anyone have any questions over anything?
No, keep rambling, bro.
What your favorite boy band is?
I'm more of a New Kids on the Block.
See, I just don't know anything after 2001.
The Carter Brothers is standalone art.
I've had a random one. Anybody remember Andrew W.?
You can give them to me or Brian, and then sometime next week I'm going to just drive them down. Their office is here in town, so it's pretty easy to just take the money straight down. So thank you guys for coming. I hope you learned something useful, even if it's just the things that I do, so now you understand what I'm doing and you can start devising ways to beat it.
That was part of our every weekend.
Throw a third line in my abdomen. These are my favorite two moves. If you roll with me regularly, I probably have done them to you multiple times. Now you know what I'm doing. You can go home and reverse engineer it and figure out how to stop me. And I would appreciate it if you did that, because then I have to evolve too. So cool. All right.
Good job.
You could definitely.
one tip thing about this, just hold this. That really moved prime forward, but it couldn't move.
Well, you had my leg guard with the cross scanner and all that, just for expedient back speed. That's the
little horn. There you go. Oh, actually,
yeah, that's what
I'm saying.
Yeah.
Then
I lost it, right?
Yeah. Like when we moved like that. But it just, it, when we're side by side like that, it's kind of like.
If I'm just here, he might extend his leg away. Thing I do is just pull this close, and there's even a funky little arm bar you can do here, but it's not high enough percentage, I think, to worry about, but I just keep this tight, like then I slide that one from there, and I'm not really giving him too much space away. And then that arm slides up to there, then you wiggle this arm out. Which sometimes, if they're savvy, they'll put weight on it, and you gotta sit there and warm for a minute.
I like how you're posting it up like this.
Yeah, he had a nice figure four grip.
I'm real spread out.
Yeah, let me see that figure four grip again. That might be a good addition to this.
Well,
so you were.
I just came
almost like a super, like a.
Yeah, so you went there.
I just came like because I want to keep on top of it.
Yeah.
What I thought.
Yeah.
And then I just peeled it.
Yeah, that's a good intermediate position because sometimes what happens is they slip their arm away in the middle of the transition. So that's a good kind of.
My fear, like I don't know anything about this position. My fear would be I do this. And
Yeah, if you lose that arm and they turtle away from you, that's the problem. So, yeah. That control. Yeah.
And then I can kind of like more action.
Yeah, and then steer it, yeah.
Although you know what turning calls, it's always like what turning calls the
ring.
Yeah. Right? That's what turning calls.
Yeah. That's a good micro transition.
Sometimes you look around and you're still like, you're not like too
to replace guard, and I'll follow with my knee to suck that space up. Then I'll slip through to my hip. And so he kind of pulled himself to his side. So you can work it both ways. They're kind of putting themselves on the side. I probably use it this way more than anything, because if they know what you're doing and they're laying on their back, they won't let you pull that leg. They'll keep it posted. So a lot of times I use this injury when they're trying to replace guard. So it's when he hits out, I follow with my knee so that he doesn't have room, and then I cover his hip with my arm so he can't roll back. Then I cover with this arm and I sit through, bringing my other knee close to his hip. Then I'm gonna pull this leg over and step this one in. Then I'm gonna switch this one in, almost like I'm putting myself back in half guard, and I'm gonna go ahead and set my lockdown. You don't absolutely have to do that. Some people will grab their position as they roll, but if I leave this loose and I start rolling, and he's savvy, he's gonna hip out and reverse the position on me. So to negate that, I go ahead and set my lockdown. Now if he tries to do that, that tension holds it steady, so I don't wind up getting reverse. So he went to do it, or I pulled him here, outside leg steps over, inside leg hooks back in, triangle, hook, and I kick out. Now there's two ways I can go here. I can do that inversion like I was just doing. So if I'm going to do that, it's easier if I climb back up, arm goes across, and then I don't do a forward roll, I do a lateral roll across my shoulders. And we roll into position, and from here I can go calf slicer, banana split, twister, back kick. And for those of you that are interested, there is another sort of hidden submission. If I pull this leg down, I can control here, establish an ankle lock grip. Usually they're not tapping to the ankle lock, they're tapping to the hip. But if they got flexible hips, you might actually ankle lock them. The other way you can enter from that position, if they know this, sometimes what people do, they make themselves kind of heavy towards this side. So I can't roll them. I grab that leg and I'm gonna fall back again.
To the other way?
Yep. And now I'm in the same position. This is usually where I'll set this type of move up from. You can also go right here, and if they got little dips, you can get a little kind of, it's kind of like the banana split, but it's a little more down like that, more in the hip block. Anyone to see either one of those again? Yeah, one more time. So, we'll say this time I sat through, I pulled his leg, step over, foot hooks, I set my lockdown. I can invert. If I got a bad back or he's heavy, I grab, I fall back, and I really got to pull this leg to get him over. It's not going to happen necessarily as easy because he's flat on his stomach, but if I pull that hard, you can almost always pull him over. And then from there, just work the submission sequence. You can run through all of them or pick your favorite. I'm not as concerned about that. Okay?
Yes, sir.
All right. I did do that the other night, actually.
Yeah.
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 got flexible arms, you throw it over your head. So your head should be pressured towards the shoulder. Some people even say like head on the mat up here. I don't think that's necessary. I want to maintain this tension, but my head should be angled down this way. Bracing against a punch coming.
So during your classes,
your
weight should be, so like these ribs up here should be down here. Move around with them, so I'm gonna see if you've got me.
I'm sure when you're going to be able to get it.
No, I'm not doing
this. Well, I mean, this one is pressure-wise. You know.
Oh, put me in real quick.
So get a little more body. So just like drop here. Yeah, like that. There we go. That's good. Yeah, you know, that's good. Let's go do that. That's what the position should be. Yeah. Consistently. Good. I want to move around some. Okay, keep that pressure just like you got it. Not quite big enough just to crush you. Is here and you're kind of trying to find the side the more slender you are, the harder it is to apply that pressure. It's also harder to apply that pressure too. So like I have a hard time thinking for Kesa because it's actually like, you got like a more of the broader rib cage and easier to squish it in. So you got more narrow than that.
Can you reach your hands together?
Looks like there is something wrong with where you put your
shoulder and so I have all this inflammation just because of
my shoulder is just fucking getting my neck fixed is what made it so tight. Because we were talking about that
for some reason.
So it's really good attack right now.
So when
do
you use those techniques to sell?
No, I had the blocks there.
That's it. You had a good injury on the tank.
Yeah, you're fine. I need to get my left shoulder just a little deeper, especially on the arm.
tie around the neck. Okay. Then this foot steps up. This foot swings so that your shin goes across his hip. And I'm like, oh, hey, please come up. Yeah, so you're like, oh, sweet, I can bridge into him, drive him down. Oh, okay. That puts him in like trouble. If you apply too much downward pressure, they do it, just stay down. Which you can use to make switches for something. You can take the top of this one. Sometimes I'm like, just leave it up. Yeah, come on. Please climb up, and then I'm already ready to go. Yeah. Oh, yeah. Well, yeah, but I need to.
Yeah, you almost have to fix my arm.
Yeah, you could do it. You would just have that in mind. It would come down to. Do I control your arm or do you control my leg? Because if you get...
He's the one that's been doing leg locks in the night.
Hey, here's what blows my mind, bro. And I mean, like, I can't get him.
Here's my take on it. Because I've had a dude just not have really.
I remember that was that jog.
Because if I have too high, it's just kind of a bad calf situation. Like it's only pain on the calf, and it is painful, and people will tap. But if someone's hopped up on adrenaline, they're just like, I'm good. There's no threat to anything, right? You know, maybe I tear his calf.